Check, check. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to Harmony. Whether it's your first time here or you're tuning in for the first time, we're glad that you've chosen to join us. Special welcome to those of you joining us online this morning. Are you guys all ready for the eclipse tomorrow? Yeah? Who's got glasses? Anyone? Yeah? You got your glasses. All right. Just as we begin the service this morning, just one announcement for you, and that is today's kind of the last day to sign up for the Spring Fling. That's our social event for singles, adult singles here in the church. And so I think there's a slide for that if the guys at the back want to advance it. But there we go, 6 o'clock on Saturday the 13th, and there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. If we can get you to sign up for that. Again, this is for adult singles here in the church. A delicious dinner and entertainment that night, Saturday, April 13th. At this time, I'm going to invite the worship team to take over and lead us as we praise the Lord together.
Good morning. Today's call to worship is from Psalms 145, verse 18. The Lord is close to all who call on Him. Yes, to all who call on Him in truth. Please stand with us and sing.
Let us worship our King. Come, let us bow. Thank you. You may be seated.
She said be seated, but I'm going to get you to do something a little bit different. We haven't done this in a long time. I don't normally do this. Some of those of us who are a little bit introverted may find this a little strange, but if you look around the room, you'll notice there are people you likely don't know. And so I'm going to invite you at this time, everyone, stand up, go greet a couple of people, especially if you see a face you don't recognize, introduce yourself, welcome them to Harmony, okay? Will everybody stand up? It's going to take a minute for that. Find our seats. Am I even on? All right, everyone. At the end of the service, we have a fellowship time in the gym, and you're welcome to carry on those conversations that you've initiated now. The Bible says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And you know what? I don't think it's just our singing that is a joyful noise. I think the noise you were just making is a joyful noise to the Lord. I think He delights in hearing the conversations that are happening, especially as we greet one another and welcome them into the presence of God. I was visiting someone this week, and I said, we're talking about people in the church. You know, when I go and visit people who are kind of shut in, they want to know what's going on, right? They want to know all the gossip, let's be honest. But I'm sharing, you know, like Rena's in Japan and Burl's in the hospital. Although, Burl, welcome back. Good to see you out of the hospital. And Rena, welcome back from Japan. But, you know, I'm sharing some of the news. But we're talking, and I find myself talking about some of the names of people that are newer here. And this person is like, who's that? I don't know who that is. And who's that? I don't know who that is. And I said, you know what? Actually, if you were to come back, there's a lot of people that you wouldn't know. God's been doing good things among us, and our numbers have been growing. In fact, last Sunday was record attendance for the past 5 years. Maybe because we had the youth choir singing. Maybe we need the youth all to lead us more out. Maybe that's part of it. But that was special. And even though we had a bunch of people here last week, and the building kind of the room full, there was over 45 people watching online last week as well. 45 different devices, so who knows how many people. But of those, at least 30 of those watch every single Sunday. In fact, I had two phone calls this week from people who watch regularly, consider themselves part of our church, and haven't been attending in person. And yet one of those individuals approached me after what they witnessed last Sunday and said, I'd like to get baptized. So it's exciting, and so now we're going to meet this week, but it's exciting what God is doing, and sometimes, you know, we think about what He's doing right here among us and the people we have conversation with over coffee after service, but the reality is there are people who very much have grown to love this church and feel a part of it who aren't actually here in person for one reason or another, and so it's just worth celebrating, I think. Over here, we have a tube we call the gratitude, and I just want to let you know through the remainder of the service, if there's something that you've seen God do in this past week, if you've witnessed God work in some special way, or if He's answered your prayers in some way, There's some yellow pieces of paper at the back just in front of the sound booth. We'd invite you to just jot a note of, hey, God, I saw you do this week. And then anytime during the service, just walk up and drop that in. There's a slot in the top of that. And this is just a visual thermometer, I guess you could say, of how we see God at work in our lives and in the life of our community. Speaking of the life of our community, we're about to receive this morning's offering. And when we take the offering, this is a chance for those of us that really call this church home to participate. And not everyone puts something in these brass plates that we pass, because some of us choose to give online.
We give through automatic withdrawal. That's something you're interested in doing. If that will help you be faithfully participating in what the church is doing, you can talk to us after the service. We can hook you up with that. But there's people that are just giving online through with their credit card or with e-transfer. There's different ways
to be involved in what God is doing here in this church and how this church is impacting our community. I just wanted to share with you really briefly that right now we chose a pretty aggressive budget for the year. We wanted to set a faith goal, something that was a little uncomfortable for us, that we'd have a hard time meeting without God really showing up in our hearts and helping us to be generous givers. Just want to let you know we're running a slight deficit right now. We're not really up to where the expenses are at. There's good reasons for that, I think, and one of the good reasons is the ministry that's happening and things like the mission trip that's just happened and the youth events and all the things, the Easter that's been going on. There's some reasons for that, but just want to let you know that, just to be to upfront with you and clear with you. We are running a slight deficit right now, and so if you're someone who's begun to attend our church and you're kind of feeling like you found a place here, we would invite you to, when you're ready, to be a part of that and to contribute in a way financially that will enable us as a church to continue to make an impact in lives just like yours. So with that, I'm going to just return thanks for this offering, these gifts that you're making, and ask God to bless them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give. It's a joy to give. Sometimes it hurts a little, especially when things are tight, and we wonder how we'll make it through the month, but yet every single month we find you're faithful. God, we have so much. And we're so thankful for that. We're thankful for the way you sustain us, even in the times when we find ourselves doubting, in the times when we find ourselves wavering. You are faithful. And God, we just are so thankful that you've called us into fellowship with you and into the work that you're doing in our world. God, we believe that you're changing Hamilton. We believe that you're at work transforming this community. And we're so excited to be a part of it. And God, we can't wait to see what you're planning to do next in us and through us here at Harmony. In Jesus' name, amen.
Here we go. Good morning. Okay, kids, who am I talking to? You guys. Yeah, my darling wife. All right, I got one for you. Let's say you've had the last couple days off school. You're sick. All right, so you've had a couple days off, but the soccer team that you're on has a game tonight at 5:30. And you'd really like to go. And you feel much better. You know, so you, mom, you know, one of those. Mom's, okay, that's fine. But you have to go to school tomorrow. And any homework you have to have done. Like if there's a test or something tomorrow, you got to be ready for it. You got to do everything to be ready for school tomorrow. Yep, fine. Okay, I'm in. I'll do that. Not a problem. So that's all happens. Your mom phones your best friend's mom, and said, gets your best friend to bring the homework home from school for you so that you can study. And you hear that there's going to be a test and you're going to have to actually do it. But that's okay. You get to go to the game. 5:30 game. Good. At 3 o'clock, everyone's letting out, and your best friend calls you and says, yeah, my dad picked me up. We're going out to get new shoes. This is so great. I can't wait. So I'm not going to be home till like 5:30 or so. And then I got to go out for dinner at my grandma's at 6:15. So if you could come between then, that'd be great. Okay, thanks. Bye. Hangs up. What are you going to do? Do you go to your soccer game? You promised your mom if you went, you know, how are you going to work this out? Now, the smart mungs among us were going, mom, would you, before you even get to there, your mom says, tell you what I'm going to do. I'll drop you off. Then I'll go to your friend's house, and I'll pick up the homework, and then I'll bring it back, and I'll watch the end of your game, and I'll see your game. That'll be fine. And then we'll come home. How's that? And instead of saying thank you, the words out of your mouth go, yeah, I'll believe that when I see it. Can you imagine what your mother would say? Well, you're not going anywhere tonight. I'll believe that when I see it. That's it. Well, that's pretty much what Thomas did. Thomas was one of Jesus' guys, one of those special 11. He was there the night that Jesus got arrested and at that Last Supper. Thomas was there. He was one of the guys that Jesus washed his feet. So he was in the inner circle. He was one of those guys. And then when Jesus got arrested and they killed him, those guys, those 11 were like, we're next. We got to hide. So they went into hiding. And they could only trust each other. Who are you going to trust? The whole big crowd that saw Jesus do miracles, now they turned on Jesus. They killed him. What do you think they're going to do to us? So they only trust each other. The only ones they can trust is each other. And Thomas comes across a couple of them, and he says, hey, Anna, how's it going, guys? And they go, we saw Jesus. Jesus is risen. We saw him. And he goes, yeah, I'll believe that when I see it. That's what Thomas said. And then if you know the story, Jesus appears to Thomas. He goes, yo, Thomas, check it out. Holes in my hand from the nails and hole in my side from the sword. And Thomas goes, oh, Lord. And he worships him, but Jesus says to him, yeah, happy are you for believing, but happier for you those who believe without seeing. And what he's talking about us. Those are us. That's us who believe without seeing. I think it would have been easy to believe if we were with Jesus when he went out and he was healing people and making people rise from the dead and he's doing these miracles. I think it'd be easy to go, yep, Son of God. That's an easy one. But for us to believe just without seeing, I think is what he's saying. Happy are those who believe without seeing. And so we don't get to say, I believe it when I see it. We only get to say, I believe it, period. So I believe it, period. And let me in on this. I'll let you in on a secret. The actual truth is, I'll see it when I believe it. Have a good day.
So being Communion Sunday, our teens will stay in the service today. And children, you can be dismissed. There's any children in congregation this morning. Just before we open God's Word together this morning, I want you to invite you to do something, and that is, I want you to reflect on your week and reflect on your mindset as you approached worship this morning, as you came in here. And I'd like you to take your hands and just put them palms up on your lap, if you would, on your knees. Just turn your hands upward. You know, I don't know about you, but at Easter, when Val was passing out the chocolates in our house, I did this, right? So she could put chocolates in my hands. Yesterday, she made monster cookies. And I said, yes, please. Put one right here. hands up is an attitude of receiving. I want you to think about your week. Think about what you've experienced. Think about the things that right now are heavy on your heart. And I want to challenge you to say, God, I need to receive from you right now. The situation that I'm in, the situation that I'm going through, I'm confused. I'm lost. I feel like hiding. So God, I need you to reveal yourself to me in this situation. I need you to give me what I need. I'm going to invite you to just a 60 seconds of silent prayer where you can have that conversation with God. You give him permission to speak with you now and to move in your life. Tell him you need to see him, and he will reveal himself to you in your situation. Take 60 seconds and just have a time of silent prayer with God. Our Heavenly Father, just like the disciples on that first Easter weekend, we may find ourselves dazed and confused, lost and afraid, hiding away out of fear. Maybe we're afraid of a medical diagnosis. Maybe we're afraid of end of life. Maybe we're afraid of the bills that are piling up, and we just don't know how we'll get through another month. Maybe we're afraid of the obstacles that lie in a relationship, and we just don't understand how we're supposed to move forward. God, we need a miracle in our lives. We need you to come through a closed door into our midst, into our moment, so that we know that we're not alone, so that we know that you keep your promises and that you're right there where we need you to be. God, we come in humility and in meekness today. We acknowledge that we don't have all the answers, that we're afraid more than we'd like to admit, and that sometimes life seems overwhelming. God, this morning our prayer is, God, I believe, so help my unbelief. God, I believe, so help me to believe. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your willingness to work in us, not because we've grown enough or are strong enough or are mature enough, but because you delight in a relationship with us. And so whoever we are, in whatever context life has us right now, at whatever place we find ourselves this morning, we know that you can come and meet us there. And so we ask you to do that now. We ask you to do that through the reading of your word. We pray that the passage of scripture we study this morning would be one that would impact us exactly where we are in our lives, and that it would help us to move from this room with confidence to share your goodness and your grace with those that we meet this week. Be with us now. In your word we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. How many of you played hide and seek when you were a child? We all played hide and seek. I know the youth group still plays hide and seek sometimes, or some variant of it, hiding in the church, and I think they delight in scaring each other, hiding in different places, playing sardines, whatever you want to call it. Hiding is something that's been a part of our nature. Isn't it interesting that a game, hide and seek, is a game that as children we delight in, that we enjoy hiding. But what is it about hide and seek that's the fun part of the game? Not being found. My favorite part of the game is being found. It's when all of a sudden, like, I don't know if you've seen little, maybe it's just my kids, but when they're little and they hide and I'm supposed to be looking for them, you know, they're like, let's play hide and seek. I'm like, that's great, go hide. Watch a little TV. Let's just let them stay hidden then. That part of the game isn't so fun. It's dad coming around the house, right? And they hear your feet on the steps. They hear the doors opening and shut. And especially when they're little, I can still remember Carson doing this. The little giggles from inside the closet or under the bed. As, you know, you knew where she was, but you pretended you didn't. Right? And you open up all the other doors going, where could she be? And you're looking, and you hear those little giggles, the anticipation of being found. I'd suggest to you that all of us want to be found. That some of us feel like we're hiding. We feel like no one really sees us. And we just want to be found. This morning's message I've entitled From Fear to Faith. As I reflected on the gospel story this week, I spent some time in John. Do you know that none of the gospels include any description of the resurrection itself? None of them. There's no record of anyone seeing Jesus actually like go from being a corpse to being alive. There's no one that actually saw him stand up and walk out of that tomb the way Lazarus did. The guards were asleep. Disciples were hiding. The details of that first morning are inconsistent. In fact, in our adult Bible study this week on Thursday morning, we were talking about the variations you'll find as you read through the different gospels. Was it one person that went to the tomb? Was it three? Did they tell anyone else? Did they keep it to themselves? The stories don't line up. They're inconsistent. And as we talked about on Thursday, the gospel writers wrote from different perspectives and they wrote from different times. Mark, that we studied last week, it was very raw, it was very fresh. John, that we're reading from this morning, he's had decades to reflect on the story before he writes this down. And so the details are different. They have different ways of telling the story. But I think what is more important to the gospel writers with regard to this post-resurrection life is not the description of a one-time historical event. What's interesting to them, what's more important to them, is the eternal presence of the living Jesus by way of the Holy Spirit. And so they don't give you that play-by-play, that exact detail of Easter morning. Rather, they spend time reflecting on how that morning changed their lives. You know, for all the splendor of our contemporary Easter celebrations, you know, with all the egg hunts and the youth choirs and all the things that happen, that first Easter happened, well, it happened in a time of darkness. A time that maybe will be a little bit more like what's going to happen tomorrow at 2 in the afternoon than an Easter sunrise service. There was darkness. There was confusion. There was fear. The early disciples just didn't get it. They didn't know what was going on, and they were afraid for their own lives. I was reading this week that with regards to the eclipse that's going to happen, you know that in ancient times, First Nations peoples and older civilizations, when they saw an eclipse, they thought it was an omen of ill, you know, bad things happening. In fact, there was a king of England who died 2 days after an eclipse, and they blamed it on the eclipse. That this eclipse had somehow impacted his life. It was dangerous to look at an eclipse. We know today that it's dangerous to look for another reason. Burn your eyeballs out. So don't do that tomorrow, unless you have those special glasses. But the disciples, they were afraid. They were hiding. They thought something bad was happening. Imagine yourself locked in a room with some other people that you had spent extended time with for a number of years. You'd kind of been building towards something. You had this idea, and then all of a sudden it's gone. Excuse me. Maybe it's a group of fellow investors. You've been pooling your money, your resources for this launch of a company, getting all ready to release this company into society, and all of a sudden that product launch didn't go well. Things crumble, or you get your business license taken away. You release the stock, and next thing you know, it's half the value. That's the disciples. They're hiding away, confused, full of fear and doubt. They're hiding from the world. And then suddenly, Jesus appears in their midst, offering peace and forgiveness. Well, today we're going to journey through John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. We're going to explore how Jesus finds us in our hiding places and transforms our fear into faith. Let's read John chapter 20, 19 to 31 together. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them this time. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you've seen me, you've believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. You know, this text from the Gospel of John is so rich and so full. I'm pretty sure I could preach several sermons from this. I mean, as I read through this story, there's so many things that go through my mind. Like, do you notice that they're meeting behind a locked door? A week later, they're still meeting behind what? A locked door. Jesus has already come. They've already seen him. They're still meeting behind a locked door. They still haven't figured it out. They're slow on the uptake. That gives me great confidence because I'm not especially quick. It's okay that sometimes we need to get the message several times before we really understand what God's trying to do in our lives. I'm thankful for that. There's one sermon. This morning, I want to concentrate on just this little portion. Because this whole chapter is a record of how different disciples, people like Mary Magdalene and Peter and John, the gathered disciples, Thomas, how different people came to believe in the risen Lord. What I find interesting about these different descriptions is that to me, it shows that these descriptions are personal experiences with Jesus and that in themselves, each of them are edifying. In other words, they can help us realize that there's no single set way in which someone comes to trust Jesus. There's no one way that we come to faith. Jesus comes to us where we are. He brings us to that place in His time, in His way. He knows how you need to receive Him. We'll talk about that more in a little bit. But first of all, let's talk about the fear and the hiding. The disciples, after what they've witnessed, hide themselves away after Jesus' crucifixion. They wonder to themselves, will the authorities that saw Jesus as a threat see us, His disciples, as a threat as well? And so questions consume them. What are we to do now? Can we show our faces in public? Will anyone recognize us? We thought He was the Messiah. He said so publicly. And we repeated it. People have heard what we said about Him. What are they going to think of us now that He's dead? And maybe they thought things like, how can I trust my own thoughts since I appear to have been very wrong about Jesus and who He was? Was that kind of stuff going through their heads? With them being overwhelmed, they hid themselves and they locked the doors. And Thomas wasn't among them. So here's the question, where was Thomas? Why wasn't he with them? The rest of the fellowship, all the rest of the disciples, we understand, it seems like the majority of them anyways, they're all gathered together. Thomas is off on his own somewhere. But here's the thing. It's been my experience, and perhaps it's been yours as well, that in life, when we face doubt and uncertainty, when we find things in our lives that are difficult, or challenging or unwelcome? Isn't it true that we tend to hide in fear? Isn't it true that we pull back from other people even? We pull away. We look for a hole to hide in. We find ourselves overwhelmed. And in that moment, often it seems like we again are unaware of the transformative power of Christ's resurrection. We forget that power. Just like the disciples, we lock the door again. But here's the good news. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, never stops seeking out our hiding places. He offers us hope and redemption. He comes to the disciples hiding away in this locked room. And here's the part of the story we don't really talk about. He doesn't say, well, Thomas, you missed your shot. I was there. He wasn't there. Too bad. He comes back a week later when Thomas is there. And he gives Thomas the ability to receive exactly what the disciples the week before had received. To see His hands, to see His side. And so the good news in that, to me, is that no matter where we are, No matter what we're going through, no matter how deeply we've hidden ourselves from God or from each other, Jesus will find us. The Good Shepherd will always find the lost sheep. If you're here in this room this morning, you're watching online, and you feel lost, I want to say to you, Jesus will find you. All you have to do, like that little child playing hide and seek, is make a little noise. If you want to be found, Jesus will find you in your situation. Just say, Jesus, find me. Maybe you've never prayed that prayer, you've never had that conversation with God, then I would encourage you this morning, if you're hearing this, have enough faith to just say, Jesus, I'm willing to be found. Come and find me. Let's move on and talk a little bit about doubt. In other words, let's talk about Thomas. His reputation has been a little bit short-circuited by his nickname, Doubting Thomas, right? He gets a bad rap. The reason he's called Doubting Thomas is because he wasn't there when the rest of the disciples saw exactly what he asks to see before he'll believe. He wasn't there when the disciples gathered on that first Easter Sunday evening. We don't know where he was. We don't know why he was absent. We just know that he wasn't there. What I want you to notice that he wasn't accused of doubting. Rather, he was accused or warned against not believing. Jesus never called him a doubter. He's just warned against not believing. Jesus didn't want Thomas's questions to short-circuit his faith. Jesus knows what's on Thomas's mind before Thomas can tell him. And this is what I find so thrilling about this story, is that Jesus honors Thomas's uncertainties by offering up physical evidence. Now, there's no account that Thomas actually sticks his fingers into Jesus' wounds. Rather, he was overcome with the recognition of the risen Lord. And what I find is that he makes, this whole passage, he's the one it points out, makes this great confession of faith, my Lord and my God. And here's why that confession of faith is so powerful. One could say that Thomas was choosing Jesus over earthly power because the Caesars, the emperor, had insisted on the title Dominus et Deus. I don't speak Latin, so I hope I got close on that. Dominus et Deus, Lord and God. So the emperor was to be addressed as Lord and God. But Thomas looks at Jesus. He looks at Jesus full in the face and he says, my Lord and God. He makes this declaration of who Jesus is, God himself, and who Jesus is to him, his Lord. And Jesus offers his disciples peace, and he addresses Thomas's doubts. But I think the important thing to recognize here is that doubt is a natural response to uncertainty. I would go so far to say as if you've never had doubts about anything in your life, you're a little bit simple. You just haven't stopped to think about the kinds of things that are going on in life. Because doubt is a natural response. It's built into us. It's hardwired into us. It's not that doubts are wrong. Rather, Jesus invites us to bring our doubts to him. Jesus, I'm unsure about this. I don't know if I have it in me to do this. Jesus, I'm not sure about my children right now. I have doubts about where they're at. Jesus says, bring it to me. And when we bring our doubts to Jesus, it allows him to deepen our faith in him. By encountering Jesus in our doubts, we find assurance and renewed faith in him. Again, I find it interesting that Thomas asks for no more evidence than the other disciples received the week before. So I think it does a disservice to him to single him out. But I think we can learn from his disinclination to believe the witness of his fellow disciples. See, they had all seen already. They'd seen the wounds. They recognized Jesus already. And so, as witnesses, they go and tell him, hey, we saw Jesus. He's like, oh, I'm not so sure. I don't know if I can really trust your opinion. You know what that tells me? Is that the gathering of disciples, the gathering of believers, is essential to our life in Christ. There's something about being together. We're strengthened and encouraged as brothers and sisters bear witness to one another about the presence of Jesus in our lives, but it helps when we're in a shared experience. And that's why coming to a place like this, being involved in each other's lives, walking with each other down this road of life, that's why it's so powerful. Because we witness God at work in each other's lives. We see it firsthand. Let me close with this, my third and final point. What is it that Jesus offers the disciples here? It's forgiveness. You see, they abandoned him. He'd spent 3 years with them. He told them what was going to happen. He said, you know, here's the mission. And they ran away from it. They abandoned their call. And he just, I give you peace. If this passage was to be written in our modern teenage language, it'd be like, we good. We're all good. We're good. That's what Jesus is saying to his best friends, to the people he'd spent this time with. Forgiveness is not earned here. It's freely given by Jesus, and it leads to reconciliation and to restoration. I want to point out really quickly that a major component in the mission of the church is the ministry of forgiveness. It's written right here for us in John chapter 20 and verse 22. Forgiveness is a major part of our mission. And here's the thing. There's a difference between the way the Catholics do that and the way the Protestants do that. You see, the Catholics perceive this as a priestly function. In other words, I, as your priest, I'm the only one that can grant forgiveness. So I'm the conduit. God, through me, I can absolve your sin. I can say you are forgiven. As Protestants, we view it as a personal and relational function. It's a way of putting into practice the kind of forgiveness that Christ offers with a view towards reconciliation. Forgiveness is something we offer to each other in the name of Jesus. And I believe that it seems to be at the core of what Jesus means when he then sends them out on their incarnational mission. It means that the cultural misunderstanding of forgiveness, that, you know, forgiveness is saying, oh, it's okay. It doesn't matter. I'll let you off. That's a fragile and temporary way of getting past off offenses. Just as Jesus forgave his disciples, so he calls us to extend forgiveness to one another. Real forgiveness, releasing each other from the bondage of resentment and bitterness. I would suggest that the reason this verse is in John chapter 20 is because Jesus knew there would be times when we would hurt one another. There'd be times when we step on each other's toes, when we somehow perhaps unintentionally, wound one another. And so he says, if you forgive anyone else's sins, they'll be forgiven. In other words, you can do what I'm doing. You can wash this away. And if you don't forgive them, they're not forgiven. In other words, if you don't forgive them, there's a block there. There's a hindrance to your fellowship. Thomas, the doubter, encounters Jesus and he receives grace beyond comprehension. This story is not about doubt as much as it's about grace. Grace is God's relentless love poured out on us despite our own unworthiness. Thomas had established the conditions for his faith. He said, I have to be able to touch Jesus' wounds. And Jesus doesn't censure him for those conditions. But instead, he makes avail to him exactly what he needs. And that leads Thomas to a place of confessing faith. To ask questions, to express doubts, to ponder, to wonder, to speak aloud, is a way to see the risen Lord. And for some of you this morning, it might be liberating to know that Jesus already knows what's on your mind. He knows your doubts. He knows your fears. He knows what you need. Thomas comes to faith when he returns to his brothers and sisters. He comes to faith in fellowship, even with his questions. And I guess I want to say to you this morning, whether you're here in the room or you're watching online, this is a safe place for you to have doubts, for you to have questions, for you to express your fears. You don't have to be perfect to be among us, because we're not perfect. This is a place where you should be able to come and express your doubts. And within the fellowship of your fellow disciples, receive what Jesus has for you. By receiving God's grace, we're transformed. We're empowered to extend His grace to others and to live lives of radical love. As together we reflect on the journey from fear to faith, let's remember that no matter how deeply we've hidden ourselves, Jesus will find us. The Good Shepherd always finds the lost sheep. And in spite of closed doors and the seclusion of frightened disciples, Jesus finds them. Because nothing keeps him from finding his own. May we all embrace the transformative power of Jesus' resurrection. May we allow our doubts to be deepened and to deepen our faith. May we extend forgiveness to one another. And may we be willing to accept forgiveness, to accept God's grace. You know, it's been my experience over the years in counseling sessions with people that I think many times it's easier for people to receive forgiveness from someone else than to forgive themselves. Sometimes long after God has forgiven you, long after someone else has forgiven you, you can't forgive yourself. There's just something you're not able to accept. Maybe you're there today. Can I encourage you to step out of your hiding place? To walk boldly in the light of Christ's resurrection. To lift your chin up, knowing that in Jesus we have hope and forgiveness and eternal life. We're going to have a few moments around the table together. And this meal that Jesus left us with is a way, is a reminder of what he's done for us and what he invites us to. Deacons, if you'll join me up here. You'll notice that the pieces of bread that are going to be distributed this morning are all approximately the same size. It's because none of us need more of Jesus or less of Jesus than someone else. None of us are more or less worthy of the sacrifice that he so freely makes. There's a reason we pass the plate. May I suggest to you that as we pass these plates of bread and juice, that act of passing is a part of our act of worship. That the passing from one to another is an illustration of passing peace, of passing forgiveness. It's an illustration of the fellowship of the church. So, as we pass these portions today, we're passing the fellowship of Christ to one another. Receive it that way today. Receive forgiveness from Jesus as you receive his body. Receive forgiveness of your sins as you drink from the cup. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "This bread is my body, which is given for you." Whenever we eat this bread, whenever we celebrate the Last Supper, we're remembering the sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf. He died that you might live. I'm going to return thanks for the bread, and then we'll distribute it. In the center of the plates are some gluten-free options for those that require it. This morning, we would invite you to receive the bread and to eat as it's passed. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your body that you so freely gave to us. Your body that was beaten, broken. It wasn't taken from you, but rather that you freely offered up so that we could find forgiveness in a relationship with you. Thank you for your sacrifice that changed everything. Thank you for giving yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. after they had eaten, Jesus took a cup of wine and he said, "This cup represents a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." A new covenant in my blood. In other words, the old ways of pleasing God are gone. The old sacrifice is gone. There's a new sacrifice. Jesus' blood paid it all. Receive the cup this morning with joy, remembering that by Jesus' blood you have forgiveness of your sins. Jesus offers. If you'd like to explore some of the themes that I mentioned this morning, I'll pass along a recommendation to you. For those of you that subscribe to Amazon Prime, there's a television show right now called The Baxter Family. And these themes of fear and doubt and hiding and misunderstanding are explored in a Christian way in that series. So I'd recommend that to you, The Baxter Family. As we leave our service, there are refreshments in the gymnasium. We'd invite you to move in there and enjoy some of the fellowship together. We have a closing. Brothers and sisters, we've gathered here to meet the risen Jesus. Wherever we've been hiding in fear, Jesus has found us, and we've encountered him in his word. Now, we are sent by that same Lord to continue his mission in a world that is desperate for the new life he gives. So as you go from this place of worship into your place of mission, go in grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, in the love of God, and in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please stand and join us as we sing in closing this morning.
Friends, if you're new around here, Love to meet you. Please come introduce yourself to me. I'll be at the back doors. Love to just meet you. And again, we have coffee in the gym. We invite you to join us for fellowship.